In this lecture, we're going to review some of the various methods sports psychologists might use to study sports psychology. Now, as an academic discipline, sports psychology is grounded in science. In fact, research is the primary focus for many people who consider themselves sports psychologists. As you recall from the history lecture, some of the earliest roots of sports psychology trace back to psychology laboratories of the late 19th century. So it's been a part of, research has been a part of sports psychology since literally the beginning of the discipline. There are, of course, other researchers who use sport as a context to understand human nature more generally. Sport may not be their primary interest, just psychology in general, but sport is a context in which to study that. And of course, the professional practice of sports psychology is also informed by science and utilizes scientific findings and the scientific method in the practice of applied sports psychology as well. Now, the scientific method, as I'm sure you've reviewed in other courses, is characterized by being systematic, repeatable, tends to have a high degree of control or controllability, trying to limit as many other explanatory variables as possible to really focus our inference on the variables of interest. It's empirical. It relies upon reliable observations. Those often get translated into numbers, but really empirical just means observations and systematic, reliable observations in the scientific method. And lastly, it's critical. There has never been a study that answers any one question once and for all. Studies undergo peer review, and other people do new studies to challenge the findings of old studies. And so science, the scientific method, is constantly evolving and renewing over time. Now, there's a number of different ways that sports psychology uses the research process. One of the goals of science is often to develop theory. Theories are a set of interrelated facts or factors that present a reliable and systematic kind of big view of some phenomenon, with the goal being to describe, explain, and predict that phenomenon over time. There will be several theories we'll touch on throughout the course. A few examples that will come up in the course include things like social cognitive theory, developed by somebody you probably heard of named Albert Bandura, a famous psychologist out of Stanford. Social cognitive theory simply predicts that the things that we think, the things we believe, the expectations that we may have, the guesses we make about the future, tend to predict what we feel and what we do. And that's social cognitive theory broadly. And of course, that influences a lot of what we'll talk about in the course. Another theory is social facilitation theory by a famous psychologist named Zients. And this predicts that doing tasks in the presence of others, so in a social context, actually facilitates performance of many tasks, that you do things better or have more strength or endurance when you're in the presence of others than when you're simply by yourself. That's another example of a theory. We'll again, as I said, return to these several of these throughout the course. Now, there's a variety of different research methods that you might see used in sports psychology. We'll come across these throughout our course. One of the first we might recognize is the correlational or observational methods. These are methods that typically have the goal of trying to understand association between two or more variables. In these kinds of studies, there's typically no manipulation or changing of the variables of interest or the independent variables. We're just simply observing associations. The main measure often used is correlation. This is a measure of covariance or the strength of covariance. How much does one variable change along with another variable? It ranges numerically from positive 1.0 to negative 1.0. Positive correlations mean the higher scores on one variable are associated with higher scores in the other variable. Negative correlations simply mean that a higher score on one variable is associated with lower scores on the other. As one goes up, the other goes down. That's a negative correlation. If they both go up or down together, that's a positive correlation. Now, one thing you always hear, and I want to emphasize again, is that correlation never implies or means causation. There's several problems with correlation and trying to infer causation. First, there's the chicken or the egg problem. We simply don't know kind of which change in which variable comes first. That's a problem. There's also this thing called the third variable problem. And the third variable means that if you see two things that covary together, it could be that one of those is causing the other to change, or it could be that there's a third variable that may be unmeasured or unknown that's actually causing them both to move together. And if it weren't for that third variable, these wouldn't have any association at all. So the third variable problem is always there. We're talking about correlational studies and correlation as a measure. We might be interested in changes over time in some studies or with some questions. This is what we might refer to as developmental research designs. We might be interested in changes over a short period of time or even over lifespan. There's a couple different ways to do this kind of research. Roughly, we can break them down into cross-sectional versus longitudinal. In the figure you see on the right here, cross-sectional is on the bottom. In cross-sectional, what you do is you try to find people right now who represent different time cohorts. So, for example, different age groups might be grouped together in a correlational study to look at changes over time based on people who are at different ages right now. That's what's called a cross-sectional design. A longitudinal design, on the other hand, follows one single group of people over time as they grow and progress through, say, different age groups or different stage of a sport development. Longitudinal designs are often preferable. They give us better answers, typically more rigorous and strong inference answers, but there's a number of limitations. For example, you can lose participants over time. If you follow people, especially over a long period of time, you just lose track of them, or some of them may die or move away or simply choose to not participate anymore. It can also take a long time to get answers, especially if you're asking questions about the impact of something that happens in childhood upon later adulthood. Well, that could take years and years to get answers to that question, and that may not be ideal either. There are also, of course, experimental methods, and that's often used in sports psychology as well. In experimental methods, we have random assignment and really tight control of extraneous variables that give us the strongest inference about the research question. Participants get randomly assigned to one or more conditions with different so-called levels of the independent variable. That may be like the presence or absence of an intervention. For example, we may be interested in how the practice of visualization impacts motor performance, like say on shooting free throws in basketball. So we might randomly assign people to a couple of groups, and with one group, we'll have them do 30 minutes of visualization of imaginary practice at their free throws, of seeing that ball go through the hoop. And the other group, we may have just sit and listen to music or something just to sort of pass the time. And then we'll see if those two groups differ. And that'll give us some inference about that intervention, whether that has an impact on a motor skill performance like free throw shooting. Now, typically with experimental methods, our interest is in the overall group effect, or what we might call on average. So on average, does the independent variable have an effect on the dependent variable? On average, does visualization help free throw shooting performance? And that may be a useful question for some designs and for some things you might be trying to answer. Usually, experimental methods do what we call maximizing internal validity, meaning they limit all the other things that could cause the changes that you observe. But they do it at the sacrifice of external validity. External validity has to do with, well, how much does what you did in the lab or what observations you make in the setting generalize to what happens in the so-called real world? That's external validity. And often we're balancing between internal and external validity when we're planning any kind of study. The more a study has internal validity in general, the more limited the external validity is, and vice versa. The more it is strongly externally valid, the more it may limit internal validity and have other kind of questions about what caused outcomes that were observed. There's also what we call quasi-experimental methods. In quasi-experimental methods, participants may exist in groups. They're called quasi-experiment because they look kind of like experiments. There may be existing groups, but those groups were formed for other than random assignment. They may be students assigned to classrooms, or they may be people on certain teams within a sports league. And the factors that led people into those groups were not entirely random. There may have been some selection bias as far as how people got in those groups. Sometimes people exist in groups that simply can't be randomly assigned. Things like gender or age cohorts or people who may have been exposed to certain events. Those just are or they aren't. We can't really manipulate that for folks, and so sometimes we use quasi-experimental methods to understand those as well. Because there's not random assignment, the conclusions we draw in quasi-experimental methods are very similar to those in correlational studies. We really can't infer causation as much as we might want to. Now, there is a challenge for the experimental method within sports psychology, and that's because in sports psychology, often we're not that interested in average performance. We're interested in improving the performance of people who are already outliers. They're already what we might call elite performers at their particular sport. If you think about the typical experimental design, you might have a control group, and then you might have an experimental group. These graphs illustrate the normal curve of the outcomes that you might see on a dependent variable. If you think about my example earlier, if we were going to investigate the impact of visualization on basketball free throw shooting performance, and say we recruit a bunch of undergraduate students, maybe who have a wide variety of experience and abilities at basketball, randomly assign them to two groups, and then do our intervention and see if it has an impact. You know, we might find that on average, yeah, people who visualize among that broadly diverse experienced and skilled group of basketball players, on average, visualization might have helped people. They did a little better. That's what our outcomes might look like in an example like this. And so you might, the dependent variable of interest would be represented by these two arrows of the averages of those two groups and seeing if those averages differ. And that can be useful to answer a lot of questions. The problem is when we're in some areas of applied sports psychology is that we're not interested in the performance of an average person. We're interested in exceptional performance by a select few. Those kind of elite performers, those who have lots of experience, talent, skill, training, preparation. And we're trying to figure out how can we make them a little bit better and how can we understand whether we made those folks better. There's a couple ways I suppose you could do that. You could try the traditional experimental method and recruit a bunch of similarly talented, trained people, but you're often going to have a very small group. Think, for example, if you're trying to determine whether an intervention helps somebody qualify for the Olympic team or to make the podium at an international competition. That's a pretty small group of folks, even if you got all of them to participate. And random assignment would be a problem because they probably all want the intervention if we think the intervention might help. So there's a lot of problems there. So there's a lot of questions about whether we can use experimental method with these kind of folks. Luckily, there are a few other things that we can do. For example, there are what we call a single subject or small n designs. These are ones where the comparison group is the participant him or herself. In the figure here, you see depicted what's called an A-B design, where in phase A, you take a number of observations of the individual themselves under their, quotes, normal or as usual condition. So we might have somebody shoot several trials of 20 free throws based on whatever they know how to do for free throw shooting right now. Then you do the intervention. For example, we might have them do some visualizations. And then we'll have them do several trials after the intervention or once the intervention is in place to see if compared to their own selves before, they get a little bit better. That would be an example of a single subject or small n design. We can also do qualitative studies. Qualitative studies don't use the same kind of reliable measurement and observations we do in most experiments, but they use interviews typically and narratives, and we look for themes that emerge that help us to generate hypotheses or conclusions about things. Case study is a specific kind of qualitative study where we look at a single case in great detail and try to account for as many variables as we can in trying to understand a single individual or a single individual's performance. And all of these methods can be valuable, but the problem is they're prone to lots of biases. They can be unreliable. And so we like to combine these with other kinds of research methods to try to draw strong conclusions. And the final research methods I will mention are reviews. So we may see meta-analyses or systematic reviews. What these do is try to look at meta-analyses are kind of a study of studies. And so they may take a look at all of the studies that have been published and try to pull those together to try to make some sense of what it all says as a whole. Individual studies can create what are called effect sizes, which tell us how large the effect is in a single study, and that can become the dependent variable for a meta-analysis. So meta-analyses and systematic reviews, our main participants in the study are other studies, and we're trying to combine those in reliable and rigorous ways to draw conclusions about the literature overall. So that gives us an overview of the various research methods used in sports psychology. We will see a number of examples of these throughout the course, and now you're familiar with what they might look like, their strengths and weaknesses, and help us interpret those as we encounter them in the rest of the course.